Nothing like starting off extremely controversial.
That's my nature.
Okay, well, I'm an invited guest, so and let me just say, I get into enough trouble for the things that I say, so don't hold me accountable to what John says or what Doug says. Deal with them if you have problems with them. As you'll see probably throughout this weekend, we do not all agree on everything that we're going to present. We do agree that Yeshua is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through him. Amen?
Amen.
He's the only way. And that it is by grace through faith. It's a free gift. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. Can we agree on that?
Yes.
Okay. Then in that sense, I consider us in unity. Okay. I consider you my brothers and sisters in Christ. Everything else is open for debate, as far as I'm concerned. It's open to discuss. Come, let us reason together, right? So, you know, things are going to be presented this weekend, and not all the speakers are going to agree. So it's up to you then to take what you are hearing and then process it and then go and search these things out to see if they be true, right? And as I start, well, today's, this first presentation, I'm calling the Seed War, Deception, Disobedience, and Exile. There's a pattern. We're often deceived, and we are deceived, we disobey, and because we disobey, we end up getting exiled. And we'll talk more about that throughout this weekend. This is sort of the three presentations I'm doing this weekend are sort of I'm cramming together information from several different presentations that I've done in the past, and I'm going to try to keep the overall, this is kind of a weird thing going on here, what's up with that? But the background of the PowerPoint presentation basically tells the presentation from which I'm deriving the information, if that makes sense, because I have all the information back there. I'm condensing a lot of things. This particular slide header is called the Genesis Revelation, how Yahuwah has revealed the end from the beginning. How many of you know that Isaiah says that God has declared the end from the beginning? You know, Amos 3:7 says that God doesn't do anything except that he tells his prophets first what he's going to do. So I believe everything we need to know has been given to us. And if we want to understand the end times, we got to go back to the beginning times. Paul talks about the Torah, and he says, these things happen to them to serve as examples for us upon whom the ends of the ages have come. So if you want to understand the book of Revelation, you got to understand Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Because it's all laid out for us there. Now, as with all of my presentations, I usually begin with the fact that three responses are typical of any size audience, whether it's 20 people or 200 people or 1,000 people. You're going to have the people that say, hey, wow, that's interesting. Okay, cool. You know, you're going to say, Rob, you need to buy stock in tinfoil. You're crazy. You're a lunatic. You know, you're out of your mind. And then there's going to be those who will, in fact, go out and search and see if these things be true. As I always say, do not believe a thing I say. John said the same thing. Look, I'm just a student just like you are. You know, I happen to be standing up here and I may be doing some teaching, but I don't consider myself a teacher. I consider myself a student with a lot of opinions that I just happen to be vocal about. all right, but you know, we are told to prove or test all things, right? Hold fast that which is good. So my prayer is that all of you will fall into category three. You will search these things out for yourself. Now, the seed war. I believe the seed war really begins right away, right? God creates Adam from the dust, right? He creates Eve. He pulls, Eve from Adam's side. He places Adam and Eve in this garden. And it says in Genesis chapter 2, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. So there's the one and only commandment they have. They got one. You know, people are all upset about the 613 commandments of the Torah, right? Or the Ten Commandments, or, the several hundred thousand commandments that we have in the laws of the United States of America. They have one commandment, and they blew it. but part of the reason for their disobedience was because they were deceived, right? We see right there in Genesis chapter 3, the serpent was more subtle than the beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, isn't that the way it usually begins? Did God really say that? Go ahead, you can do that, right? You shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. Did God really say that? Were they allowed to touch it?
Yes.
God never said anything that they couldn't touch it. He just said they couldn't eat it. But I have a feeling that Adam probably was giving a little bit of extra. Look, don't even go near the thing, honey. Stay away from that thing. Right? We only got one commandment, right? So let's just don't even go near the thing. You know? So I have a feeling the reason why she's saying that is this is speculation. It's probably because Adam added a little bit to it. But you know, where's Adam here during this whole discussion that's taking place with the serpent? But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, you're not going to die, right? God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. I see three promises of the serpent right there. Do you see them? Promise of immortality. You're not going to die. Your eyes are going to be open. You have greater wisdom and understanding, right? And you shall be like God. You know what's crazy about that? They already had all three. Right? Death didn't come until sin. Right? Sin brought death. So they're already immortal. Having your eyes open, wisdom, understanding, and that kind of... They were walking in the garden with God. Whatever they didn't know... They had the Creator right there with them. They could ask them, right? And you shall be as like God. Well, they were made in the image and likeness of God right from the beginning, right? Three promises. The devil deceived them. Now, who was the first sinner? Adam or Eve? Well, Eve disobeyed first, but we are told that it was through Adam that sin entered the world. For wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Yeah, she screwed up. He had a chance to redeem the situation, though, didn't he?
How would he have redeemed that situation?
I don't know. It's speculation at this point. I don't know. But there are many times where we see, like in throughout the Torah, that the husband has the power to annul various things that the woman does. So, you know, I don't know. We're not told what could have happened. All we know is that he followed suit, did the same thing she did, and then by him, sin entered the world. Now, how do we define sin? What is sin? That's right. That's also given for us in Scripture. 1 John chapter 3. For sin, for whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. So they had one commandment in the garden. That was the law. Don't eat from that tree. Well, they ate from the tree. That's why it's sin. They transgressed. Now, whenever there's disobedience, you end up with exile in some form. You know, whether it's a physical relocation or whether it's a distance from God or whatever, sin brings exile. We see in Genesis chapter 3, and the Lord God said, behold, the man is become as one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever, therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden. That's an act of mercy right there. Why? Why would I say that? Why were they exiled from the garden? Live forever in a fallen state. Right, exactly. So they drove the man out and placed at the east of the Garden of Eden. And he placed the first lightsaber there. George Lucas didn't invent the lightsaber. We have this cherubim with a flaming sword right there to keep them out. This header, the slide header right there, it's kind of cut off right there, but it's from the Yahuwah Triangle series that I did. Which is also all available online on YouTube. If you just want to watch the whole thing, it's on there. In that teaching, and we don't have time to get into it really right here, but in that teaching, it is my firm belief that I believe that the Garden of Eden was in the location we now call Israel. And specifically, that the location of the two trees is Shechem. Shechem in the land of Israel. Don't have time to unpack that here. Ask me later if you're interested. But I believe that was the Garden of Eden, and they were booted out of it. They're booted to the east. Well, it's interesting, if you read the book of Leviticus, it talks about if you're in that land, it's not the land of the Jews. It's not the land of Israel. It's the land of Yahuwah. It's the land of God. It's his land. He's the landlord. He has house rules. When I live in a two-bedroom apartment, when I got my apartment, I had to page after page of documents I had to read through and initial and sign. These are the regulations of living in my apartment complex. If I'm in violation of those, what do you think happens to me? I get evicted. I get kicked out. I end up on the side of the road with all my furniture. You know? Well, that's God's land. It's his. He's the landlord. He's got house rules. If you violate those rules, Leviticus 18 says the land vomits you out. The land will vomit you out. Well, Adam and Eve were vomited. They were the first to be vomited out of that land, sent to the east. This is where I believe they ended up. And again, I don't have time to go into all this right here, but I created this drawing actually back in 2009. It was like a vision I felt like the Lord was giving me. And so I created it, but I didn't really know entirely what it meant. I had some general ideas what it meant, but in 2014, he really caused me to dive in and go a lot deeper and to define what that means, and that's what the Yahuwah Triangle teaching was all about. But essentially, I believe that they were in Shechem, that's where the two trees were, and they were booted out to the east. Now, this looks like a kind of an angle right there, but it's just the way it looks on Google Earth. It's almost exactly due east from Shechem is Babylon. And I believe that that's where they were exiled to Babylon. So after they're kicked out of the garden, you know, they have two sons, right, Cain and Abel. And next thing we see, Cain kills Abel. So the bad one kills the good one, right? Then eventually they have another son, Seth, right? Now, if you had children, and you know, if you had two sons and one of them kills the other and you have another son, do you think you might just be a little protective of that third child? I think they were extremely protective of Seth, in my opinion. So we turn the page. The devil's got sort of a plan B, if you will, or maybe plan C in this case. And it's what I call the Genesis 6 experiment. Now, when you read Genesis 6, it talks about the sons of God came unto the daughters of men. The question then becomes, are we talking about the sons of God, as the text says, or are we talking about the sons of Seth, as seminarian people say? Well, the text says sons of God. And there is absolutely nothing in Genesis 6 which in any way refers to Seth or Cain or their offspring. Rather, the phrase sons of God is a reference applied to angels, just as it was in the book of Job, which incidentally predates the book of Genesis. We see in Job chapter 38, during the creation account, we see the morning stars saying together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Simple question. Were the alleged good sons of Seth there at the time of creation? No. So Genesis has to be understood in terms of what Moses understood at that time. And Job predates Genesis. The phrase sons of God was a reference to angels, not the good sons of Seth. If we were to extend our research a little bit into what I call the synchronized, biblically endorsed, extra-biblical texts of Enoch, Joshua, and Jubilees, I refer to these books that way because they are synchronized in the sense that they tell the same story in the same chronological order of events that we find in the book of Genesis. I call them biblically endorsed because the authors of Scripture are constantly quoting from these guys, making references that can only be found in these books. You know, like Paul's talking, I think it was to Timothy, and he's talking about Jannes and Jambres, the two individuals that opposed Moses in Pharaoh's court. Well, if you read the Torah, the names of the Pharaoh, of the magicians are not given. We have no idea who they are. So how did Paul know Jannes and Jambres? Well, he knew because Joshua tells you that's the name of the two guys that opposed Moses. So it's evident. There's lots of internal evidence throughout the Scriptures that the authors of canonized texts referred to these books constantly. And Jude, you know, cut and paste a paragraph out of Enoch into his little book, right? So do you believe that the Bible is divinely inspired by the Holy Spirit and written by men? I do. So then under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, these guys were authorized to quote from these books. That feels like an endorsement. That's a pretty good endorsement. I mean, can you imagine? I just think, wow, man, how cool would it be if somebody starts writing Scripture right now, it's divinely inspired Scripture, and they quote from one of my books? That'd be good for some sales. You know? That's an endorsement of these texts. And, of course, extra-biblical because they're not currently found within the covers of our canonized text. Okay, that's why I refer to them that way. However, my position on these books is that I view I'm happy with the 66 books. You know, it's great, wonderful. That's my touchstone. Anything else that I'm going to look at or read has to agree with that. If it disagrees in any way, I toss that information out. If it agrees, okay, great, then it's added information. All right? That's just the way that I view those books. When you look into those books regarding Genesis 6 and what I call the Genesis 6 experiment, we have the sons of God in Genesis 6, 1 and 2, syncing up to the exact same chapter and verse. You have 1 Enoch chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, says the angels, point blank, the children of heaven, and Jubilees says the angels of God. So right there, I mean, it clears all any question you might have up right there. And if you might think of these other books also as commentary, ancient commentary. Now, I believe Enoch predates even the Torah. But Joshua and Jubilees, Joshua, I believe, was contemporary with the Torah because it's quoted in the book of Joshua, where it says, is it not written in the book of Joshua that Joshua commanded the sun to stand still? Well, for Joshua to make that statement, that means Joshua had to have already been written, you know, right, contemporary with the time of the Torah, I believe. Jubilees, I believe, shows up way later, about, you know, 300 B.C., somewhere thereabouts. All right, but these guys are all, you know, if you look at, like, Joshua and Jubilees as commentary, they clearly understood that we're talking about angels here, at least in Jubilees. You look at some of the quote-unquote early church fathers, you'll see people like Philo in 50 AD talking about the angels coming down with mortal women, and Philo says Moses stylized the angels as the sons of God. Philo writing 50 AD. Clement talks about the angels becoming in every way like humans, and they partook in human lust, came together, a disciple of Peter. Of course, Josephus comes right out and tells you in Antiquity of the Jews, Book 1, Chapter 3, for many angels of God accompanied with women. He goes on to say, hey, we even still have the bones of these offspring. I mean, these things were so huge. I mean, they have them on display over here. You know, here's the Nephilim display clause, you know, over here, display. So what I think we have going on is a whisper down the lane. You ever play that game, whisper down the line? You know, you tell one person something, by the time it gets to the end, it's totally different. I think this is what we have here is in the beginning, the ancient record is unanimous. It's in unanimous agreement until you get to about 160 AD when the bogus Sethite theory starts to originate. Prior to that, everybody understood that we're talking about angels mating with women in Genesis chapter 6. If you imagine each of these people as representing 1,000 years, 6,000 years later, we get to today, and now you go to seminary, and we heard that the sons of Seth mated with Cain's daughters. The story has changed over time. So, what happened during the Genesis 6 experiment? A gentleman by the name of David Flynn realized something. He was looking at like a map with the longitude and latitude lines on it, that the location of Mount Hermon, which is where they came down in Genesis 6, was 33.33 degrees north by 33.33 degrees east from the Paris prime meridian, which was the prime meridian before they changed it to Greenwich. So that's very interesting. He also noticed that it was 2012 nautical miles to the Paris prime meridian from that location, and also 2012 nautical miles to the equator. All very interesting. That caused a lot of people, a lot of different researchers to speculate. You know, when everybody was talking about December 21st, 2012, you know, that was the Aztec calendar stone, the Mayan calendar and all that. That was just some of the, this information right there is one of those things that made people go, could something happen then? A lot of speculation, of course, taking place. Now, this is what Mount Hermon looks like today. That's where we see in Genesis 6:4, the Nephilim were in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same were the mighty men that were of old, the men of renown. This teaching's from my Archon Invasion series. Who or what is an archon? It's just a Greek word. The word means prince, you know, right here in Ephesians 2:2, where it talks about the according to the prince of the power of the air. The Greek word archon just simply means a chief, a ruler, prince, leader, command, somebody in a position of authority. There's nothing special about it. Today, however, in various New Age and occult circles and stuff like that, archon has taken on sort of a whole other meaning. But at its root, it's just simply somebody in a position of authority, leadership. And we read about 20 archons that were the leaders of the 200 watcher-class angels that sinned with the daughters of men. And they give you the names in 1 Enoch chapter 6. It says that they came. The 200 watcher-class angels came down in the days of Jared on Mount Hermon. And we get a bunch of names right here in Enoch chapter 6. Those would be the archons. Those would be the leaders of the 200, yes.
When you say angel in that context, is that like literally angel or is it divine?
Well, I mean, I think it's generally assumed that divine beings are, you're either talking about God or his created angels that are in that realm with him. So I don't know that there would be any other class that we would consider.
Well, I don't know, like if you listen to Michael Heiser's teaching on that.
Yeah.
And he says it's not angels per se.
That watchers are not angels?
Yeah. No, that the Nephilim, the sons of God in that verse were gods and separate from angels.
Yeah, I'm familiar with some of his stuff. My take on it is that there are different classes of angels.
Okay.
You know, if you want to go with the divine council class, you know, they have a certain role. You have the messenger class angels. You have the watcher class angels, which would be these guys right here. You have the cherubim class of angels. You have the seraphim class of angels. You have the archangel class of angels. So the heavenly army class, you know, so there are obviously different classes of angels, but I think we're still talking about angels. That would be my take on it. And when it's talking about the 200 watcher class angels and the archon leaders of them, these are the ones that Peter and Jude are referring to as the angels that sinned. The people who teach, both in the Torah community as well as in standard Christianity coming from seminary, that the sons of God are the sons of Seth, they got a big problem with Peter and Jude. Because Peter and Jude refer to angels that sinned and that were punished and bound in chains and put in Tartarus. You cannot say that these are the one-third of the angels that fell with Lucifer. You can't say that because those angels are still out and about. They're the principalities and powers of spiritual wickedness in high places that we wrestle with. And the devil goes about as a roaring lion, right, seeking whom he may devour. So the devil and his one-third are still out and about. So that then begs the question, who are the people who are the angels that are bound up in chains and put in Tartarus? So they have no answer for that if you go the route of the sons of Seth. Makes perfect sense if you know what the sons of God were angels. These are the ones that they're talking about. They were the ones judged, bound, and buried for 70 generations. Keep that number in mind, 70 generations. I'm a visual person, so I like to put together timelines and things like that. And when I was looking through all this research and trying to figure out the timeline of when all these things took place, I came to the conclusion that the days of Jared, the Genesis 6 experiment, took place in roughly 3550 B.C. And then when you read through the book of Enoch, it says that the first generation Nephilim would only live for 500 years. And within those 500 years, they were to kill each other off in a massive civil war that the Greeks later stylized in what became known as the Clash of the Titans. See the movies and stuff in the Clash of the Titans? So that happened, you know, if you go forward 500 years from 3550 BC, you end up right around the 3000 BC timeframe, where a whole lot of other interesting things start to show up, like the Aztec calendar stone shows up. I know it says Mayan calendar, but it's really the Aztec calendar stone, 3114 BC. Shortly thereafter that showed up, we have the death of Adam, the first human dies. Then we have the end of the first generation Nephilim, the end of the Clash of the Titans. Then we find that the Watchers, the parents of these guys, were judged, bound, and buried for 70 generations. And then Enoch gets raptured, and then there's this time of peace. About 60 to 70 years, you have this time of peace. And Noah's born, and his daddy names him Rest. You know, Rest, because they were in a time of peace. It was after the Clash of the Titans. And then from that point on, there is no further written documentation of any other incursion of angels mating with women. I know there are a lot of other speakers out there that talk about the Nephilim, and pretty much all of them believe that angels came back and mated with women again based on absolutely zero textual evidence, including Genesis 6:4. Genesis 6:4 does not support a multiple incursion. And part of the reason why I do not believe the angels ever came back and did it again is because of God's severe judgment on the ones who did it the first time. The judgment was just extremely severe. I'm not going to take the time to read all this right here, but this is the passage, 1 Enoch chapter 10, verses 9 through 12, that said part of the watcher's severe judgment was to watch their own children kill each other off. Any parents here? Raise your hand. How many of you parents would love to see your kids massacre each other? No, that'd be horrible. Nobody. He's like, are they teenagers? No parent that really loves their children would want to see that. And we see that the Watchers did love their children because the text refers to them as their beloved ones. So part of their severe judgment was to watch their own children kill each other off. Then they were judged, bound, and buried, bound in chains, and put in Tartarus, and buried under the sands of the earth and whatnot for 70 generations. And all that's right there in 1 Enoch chapter 10. And if you go a little bit further in the book of Enoch, while the judgment's taking place, Michael, the mighty archangel himself, I mean, next to the Godhead, there's no one tougher than Michael. He takes out Lucifer, right? Later. He's the big tough guy. Michael, the toughest of the toughest, is looking at the judgment that's taking place there, and I'm going to paraphrase what you see up there. He's like, dude, no one's going to do that again. I mean, Michael is trembling in fear. And he's talking to Raphael, and he says, man, the power of the Spirit transport, it makes me tremble because of the severity of the judgment. Michael says, it's not going to happen again. That's so terrible. In my Mount Hermon Roswell teaching, I give several other reasons why I do not believe there was any other incursion. Of course, the judgment was extremely severe. There's no confirming scriptures. Scripture says you need 2 to 3 witnesses to establish truth. So you don't go basing any doctrine or idea on one text. You need to find the confirming witness. There's no confirming witness for the assumption that Genesis 6:4, where it says, and also after that, is talking about a post-flood incursion of angels. The size of the giants begins to drop dramatically. If you read the text to talk about the first generation, they got as tall as 3,000 ells, which Dr. A. Nyland says was 300 cubits, which translated into feet, about 450 feet. Now, we can't conceive of a person 450 feet tall, which is interesting because that's the same dimension as the length of the ark. But the Greeks had no problem with it. They called them the Titans. In fact, if you watch some of these movies that come out, like The Wrath of the Titans and stuff like that, when they bring back Kronos, they depict them as a 400-foot giant. You know, they understood it. They were huge. But in the post-flood world, the tallest ones we read about are as tall as cedar trees. Now, that's still massively huge. A modest cedar tree is 35 feet tall. The cedars of Lebanon got to 150 feet tall. That's still a lot shorter than 450 footers. So, and by the time you get to Goliath, he's a runt. I mean, he's like 9 or 12 feet tall. He's a short guy. So size drops dramatically. There's no explanation from that from the multiple incursion people. And the world should have become completely corrupted 5 times over. In the 1,200 years that took place from the days of Jared leading up to the flood, it said the earth, all flesh had become corrupted. The whole world became corrupted in 1,200 years. Now, I was in the army for 6.5 years, you know, and being in the military, if I looked at this as sort of as a military tactician, if I was the commander of the fallen ones, let's say I'm Satan, and 200 of my guys were able to corrupt the whole world in 1,200 years, what do you think I'm going to do? 400. Let's go. You know, let's get this over with. Let's just bring everybody down there. They've had 5,000 years to repeat what they did. Why are we still here with that kind of successful campaign? No. So I talk about that more. And why science instead of sex, that gets into the whole alien abduction routine. I don't have time to cover that here. Genesis 6:4 itself, I maintain, doesn't even support the idea of multiple incursions. If you just read the text, it says the Nephilim were in the earth in those days. What days? Well, if you continue reading in all the other supporting texts, the days of Jared. And also after that, when is that? The days of Jared. When the sons of God, who are the angels, came unto the daughters of men, when? In the days of Jared. And they bare children to them. The same who were born in the days of Jared were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown. The word old comes from the Hebrew word olam, which is translated very often, about 100-plus times, as forever and or everlasting. So nothing about Genesis 6:4 even remotely supports the idea that we're talking about angels coming back again after the flood. So after I'm looking at this text and realize after the first incursion, 3550 BC, 500 years later, those children are all dead. Well, we still got, you know, another 700 years or so to go to get to the flood. I realized that there was actually a pre-flood return of the Nephilim, but it didn't come about as a result of angels mating with women. When you take the ancient texts and you synchronize them together, again, I don't have time to go through all this. You can see it on the board. The text in black is the Genesis text, and the text in red is the supporting text. You see the breakdown of events, how everything took place, what happened when, and we see in Genesis chapter 6, verses 8 through 10, that Noah was genetically pure. Now, his wife, according to the extra biblical text, was the daughter of Enoch. So we know Enoch was a good guy, right? He was so righteous, God took him, right? So good pick for a wife for Noah. So if Noah and his wife are genetically pure, it stands to reason then that his three sons are pure too, right? Everybody with me? No mention of angels, Noah and his wife and his three sons are pure. Who's left?
The wives.
That's all you have left. Occam's razor, right? When you have competing ideas, the one that requires the least amount of assumptions, probably the right one. Well, and the wives don't even show up until verse 18. Chapter 6, verses 11 and 12 says, all flesh became corrupted. How much is all?
All.
With the exception of those who are genetically pure in the verses prior, right? Because those are singled out. These guys are pure. Wives aren't mentioned until verse 18. Quick quiz. Does 18 come before or after 12?
After.
Right. Okay. So I want to unpack Genesis 6:12 because it says that all flesh should become corrupted. Well, the extra biblical text of Joshua goes into a whole lot more detail and tells you that how they became corrupted is they began to blend species together. They began to blend animals and plants and reptiles and fish and birds and people. The corruption of all flesh came as a result not of angels mating with women, but as a result of blending species. Well, guess what we're doing today?
Blending species.
Ah. Now, Yeshua said, Matthew 24:37, that the last days would be like the days of Noah, not the days of Jared. The days of Jared were angels mating with women. The days of Noah, especially specifically the last 120 years leading up to the flood, were all about genetic modification. Also confirmed in Jubilee 7:24. And this is a recap. This is after the flood. Noah's kind of giving a recap of what happened that led to the flood. The angels mate with women, all that stuff. And he says, and after this. The after this is in a pre-flood context. The after this of Jubilee 7:24 is the after that of Genesis 6:4. They sinned against the beasts and the birds and all that moveth and walketh on the earth. And much blood was shed on the earth. And every imagination and desire of men imagined vanity and evil continually. It became, the violence was a byproduct of the blending of species. I'll talk a little bit more about that. Taking that diagram that I had up there earlier and expanding it a little bit to the last 120 years leading up to the flood, that's when what I call the end. Also after that, latter-day corruption of all flesh took place. And part of what I'm looking at there is, I believe, defined for us in Genesis 6:3. Genesis 6:3 talks about God saying that my spirit's no longer going to dwell with you. For man is flesh, and he has 120 years, right? Well, a lot of people take the 120-year thing there in Genesis 6:3 and spin it off into jubilees and all kinds of stuff. Well, you know, it's interesting that, you know, 120 jubilees would be 6,000 years. That's cool. But that has nothing to do with Genesis 6:3. Genesis 6:3 is not talking about jubilees. It's talking about, hey, if you guys don't knock off, if you don't knock it off, this activity that you're doing, a blending species and genetically modifying all the kinds that I set apart and said everything must reproduce after what? Its own kind. If you guys don't knock it off, You're messing up my house. He created us to be what? The temple of what? The Holy Ghost. He created us in the image and likeness of himself. He created a like body for him to inhabit. But if you start blending species into your body and jacking up your house, he's saying, hey, you better knock it off. I'm not going to be able to hang out with you anymore because you're not looking like the image and likeness that I created you to be. That's what's going on right there. I got T-Rex in there. I personally believe T-Rex was a genetically modified dinosaur. I believe dinosaurs did coexist with man. But I think when we're talking about the dinosaurs that God created, I believe we're talking about the herbivore class dinosaurs. You know, and then they started blending species together, and I think we ended up with, you know, Velociraptor and T-Rex and stuff like that. While I was kind of formulating all these theories in my head, I had these two books sitting on my desk, arranged in the order that you see up there on the screen. Doug Hamp's book on the left, Corrupting the Image, and Tom Anita Horn's book, Forbidden Gates, on the right. Just both of them sitting on the desk, and I'm like, wow, is that the formula? Is the formula, when you corrupt the image that God originally created and the like kinds that he originally created and called good, you start corrupting that, does it open up forbidden gates to bring about the creation of Nephilim? I believe, yes, that's exactly what happens. And if you look at the word Nephilim, it's derived from the word Nephal. Most people say the word means to fall, or the fallen ones. Well, that's true. It's one of the definitions. But there's a bunch of other definitions for the same word, like to be judged. And I think when you start messing around with God's stuff, you're going to get judged. You know, that's what's going to happen. Basically, I define Nephilim as that which has fallen from the original state or the kind that God created. And again, while I was thinking about these things, the movie Spider-Man came out. And it was the movie, the Spider-Man movie, where his enemy was the lizard. And if you've seen the movie, the scientist, he was a good guy. He was missing part of his arm. You know, he lost it in combat. And he just said, you know, what is the code that allows you to chop off the tail of a lizard and it grows back? What's the regeneration code? So he starts cutting the legs off of mice and rats and stuff like that and tinkering with the DNA until finally he gets a combination that works. And then one of the mice grows its leg back and he's like, ah, I figured it out. Eureka, right? So he injects himself with the same formula and his arm grows back. That's awesome. But he had an unfortunate side effect in that he became a giant lizard man that had only evil continually in his heart and mind for the rest of the movie. I'm like, man, Hollywood gets it. You know, the church is still fighting about the Sethite theory, but they're showing a guy who is a normal, good guy who starts blending himself with other DNA, and the result was having only evil continually in his heart and mind, in addition to becoming a giant lizard man. yeah, I think that's exactly what was taking place. And so then that brings us to the post-flood return of the Nephilim. Of course, we have the flood take place, you know, and then after the flood, the giants are there right away. You know, so whether you believe what I'm talking about or you believe the angels came down and made it with women, the net result is exactly the same. You still have giants after the flood. Either way, the net result is exactly the same. But I think the smoking gun that obliterates the whole idea of multiple incursions is the same guy, Moses, who wrote Genesis 6, also wrote the rest of the book, the rest of the Torah. And he wrote in Genesis chapter 9, just three chapters later, verse 18 and 19, he said, the sons of Noah that went forth of the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And Ham is the father of Canaan. Why did he just insert that there? Oh, no, by the way, Ham is the father of Canaan. Who were the Israelites always having to deal with in the land? The Canaanites. Who were the ones that they were consistently told to utterly destroy? Kill the women, kill the children, kill the animals, wipe out everything. Don't even eat the food until the third or fourth generation of produce. Canaanites. Ham is the father of Canaan. Not an angel. Right there. And if you still didn't get it, verse 19, it says, these are the three sons of Noah, and of them was the whole world overspread. Other translations say populated. The whole earth was populated by these three guys. No mention of angels anywhere in the picture. So when you look at the breakdown of their offspring, Ham by far has some very interesting kids. There are many giants in the offspring of Canaan, obviously the Canaanites we talked about. There's at least one in Mitzrayim's line. That being Kaftor. None that I could find in Put, and one in Cush, but I don't believe he was born that way. I believe he did something to modify himself and became that way, and that would be Nimrod. The Amorites are mentioned over 80 times in your Bible. Amorites described by the book of Amos as being as tall as cedar trees. They come from Canaan, son of Ham, no mention of angels. And the Philistines mentioned over 200 times, and they come from Kaftor, son of Mitzrayim, son of Ham, no mention of angels anywhere. So, and we know of at least a few famous Philistines, right? Goliath and his brothers. Yeah. So clearly something's going on there. There's no giants anywhere in the line of Shem that I could find anyway. That's a good thing. Who come from Shem? Yeshua comes from Shem. Right. So he's, that line's pure. And there, yeah, right. Son of man. Pure. Genetically pure. And there's some in Japheth. Now, you won't get this in Scripture. You won't find this information in Scripture. If you look through history, however, just do a Google search on Gog and Magog plus giant. And you'll see that all throughout history, many different cultures understood that Gog and Magog were giants. In fact, every year to this day, they still have a parade. It still takes place even today, where they march these two giant statues through the streets of the UK. It's called the Lord Mayor Parade. The Lord Mayor Parade was created, was founded by King John Lackland, the signer of the Magna Carta, who, by the way, all of our presidents just so happen to be related to.
Just a coincidence,
right? I mean, what would the statistical odds be if we have presidents of the people, for the people, by the people, like we are all taught and brainwashed to believe, that they would all be related, not just to each other, but to the guy who created the Nephilim Parade that they still have every year? Call me crazy, but I don't think your votes matter. That's another lecture. That deals with deception. You want to decode deception? There's a little piece of it for you right there. I stood on the Great Wall of China when I was a missionary. I was in China, and see all these little people? I mean, that wall is huge. In fact, there's a new, I think it's a Matt Damon movie coming out. It's called The Wall. where, at least from the previews, it looked very interesting. It's like, you know, they're fighting something. They don't really show what it is. And, like, this big hand comes and starts yanking people off the wall and stuff like that. I mean, I don't know what the movie's going to be about, but it looks like they understand this, the reason why that wall was built. When you see that thing, it is so huge. It is massive overkill if you're just trying to keep out six-foot-tall invaders. If you're trying to keep out the hordes of Gog and Magog, on the other hand, well, that makes a lot more sense. In fact, there was a Geico commercial that actually showed that. You ever see that Geico commercial? They had these, like, Mongolian-looking guys that come up on the Great Wall of China. It's, like, this tall. And they're looking at it like, what do we do? And the other guy looks at him, he's just steps over and walking on. I'm like, even Geico gets it, you know? When I was at the Great Wall of China, I found out that one of the original names for the Great Wall of China was called the Ramparts of Magog. The Ramparts of Gog and Magog. So Japheth apparently had some giants in his line as well. When you look at the lineage specifically of Ham in Genesis chapter 10, verses 6 through 20, and you get one of those books, there's a really good book called A Dictionary of Scripture Proper Names by J.B. Jackson. The whole book is just all the names in the Bible and the corresponding meaning of their names. Right? If you look up the names of the people in Ham's lineage in Genesis 10, 6 through 20, I mean, look at the meaning of their names, right? Proud parents, you guys raised your hands earlier. What would possess you to turn to your spouse after you just have your newborn baby and say, enclosure of wrath, what do you think, honey? Or terror, or blades, or, you know, why would you name your kid something like that unless there's something clearly wrong with that kid? Now, you may name your teenager terror later, but the babies, clearly something's going on with these kids. Well, yeah, all of the post-flood Nephilim trace back to these guys. These are the ones that they're told to utterly destroy. And we have scriptures such as Deuteronomy 20:17 to look at, to point to for what I just said. It says, but thou shalt utterly destroy them, namely the Hittites, Amorites, Canaanites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. Well, what do you know? Those are the same people that show up in Genesis chapter 10, verses 15 through 18, with no mention of angels anywhere. What do you know? And again, Genesis 9 says, Ham's the father of Canaan. These guys populated the whole world. In the post-flood world, this is a conservative scale, I think. You know, you have a normal six-foot-tall person on the left here. Goliath is somewhere between 9 and 12 feet tall, depending on who you read, regarding the cubit and all that. Og of Bashan is typically understood to be somewhere between 15 and 18 feet tall. And the Anakim, the early Canaanites that made the Hebrew spies feel like grasshoppers, I believe are in the 24 to 36 foot realm, being conservative. Again, cedar trees, the cedars of Lebanon are 150 feet tall. So when they're saying they're as tall as the cedars, were they referring to the cedars of Lebanon? I don't know, but just going erring on the small side, that's what you're looking at in the post-flood world. And when you understand that, I think we have to rethink some of the scriptures and some of the passages and some of the characters that we're familiar with in the Old Testament, like Abraham. We think of Abraham as typically this kind of frail old guy with the long beard. Father Abraham, right? I'm thinking, you know, yeah, I mentioned he eventually got that way, but I think this is probably a better idea of something like, you know, early Abraham, you know, before he became that frail old guy. Because when you start reading, like, the Genesis 14 war, that's a crazy war right there. That war is Lord of the Rings territory, all right? You just go through and read that. It's the four kings against the five kings, and the four kings beat the five kings and chased them all into the slime pits, which later became the Sodom and Gomorrah, you know, all that whole thing right there. It says Lot was taken. Lot and his family were captured as spoils of war, right? The four kings beat the five kings, took Lot and his family. Abraham goes, I don't think so. Gets together a band of 318 guys. You know, remember 300? 318 guys. And it says that they slaughtered Keter La'amar. Now, Keter La'amar was Amraphel. Amraphel was the title of Nimrod. Amraphel is Nimrod. Joshua tells you that. And Keter La'amar is like his general Patton. And Abraham and his boys utterly destroyed, slaughtered Keter La'amar, who was the leader of the armies that just wiped out five giant armies worth of, you know, their enemies. Abraham and 300 guys. Now, Abraham had some interesting allies, though. Mamre, Aner, and Eshcol, who were also giants, I believe. So that's rather interesting. Josephus just comes right out and tells you. If you're misunderstanding it just from reading the Genesis text, Josephus breaks it down and just tells you right point blank in Antiquity of the Jews. It says, these kings laid waste to all Assyria and overthrown the offspring of the giants. He tells you point blank. This was a war against giants. And put that a little bit into perspective. You know, I believe this is something like what the Hebrew spies may have encountered when they went into the land and they saw the giant. They felt like grasshoppers. And I love Caleb. He's like, yeah, what's the problem? Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and occupy, for we are well able to overcome it. I'm like, dude. You know, everybody gives the spies a bad rap, but I mean, come on. Now, to be fair, I understand why God got mad, because God had just delivered him from Egypt and the pillar of fire and, you know, all the split in the Red Sea and all of the stuff that God had already proved to them, hey, I'm with you. Don't worry about what you see. I'll take care of it. But if you're just a normal human guy and you see something like that, I can understand why people are like, whoa, yip, 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 yip. Yeah. So, again, I like to put together timeline charts. I have these in the back if you want to check them out. The Genesis 14 came from this chart right here. But as I was looking through that research, I also noticed something interesting in the story where Sarah dies, right? Abraham had to bury his wife. It says he negotiates with an individual named Ephron of the Hittites. Several places it says that. Well, when you look into the Hittites are among the group of people that God says utterly destroy. So we know they're Nephilim. The Hittites have many different carvings and depictions of animal-human hybrids. You got a satyr dude right here, two of them, and you got lion men, human body, lion head. The scripture talks about them fighting against lion men of Moab. You know? So, I mean, you got some, if you kind of know what to look for, you'll start seeing lots of wild stuff in your scriptures. And when you look up Ephron's name in that book, J.B. Jackson's book, Dictionary of Scripture Proper Names, Ephron's name means fawn-like. The Hittites' name, they're the terrors. The terrors have depictions of satyrs. Makes you wonder. I can't say this for a fact, but it makes you wonder, was Ephron a satyr? I'm just putting it out there. And if you read the book of Joshua, you'll see that there's an account. I think the prophet's name was Zepho or something. I think it was a descendant of Esau. He's going out trying to find his donkey, and he hears a noise. He goes into a cave, and it describes a person that from the waist down was a goat, and from the waist up was a human. That's messed with it, so he kills it. But it's just, when you read it, it's just written matter of fact. It's like, yeah, I killed a horse, you know? You know, to us, we're like, what? But to them, it's like, yeah, you know, I killed a satyr, you know, or we just went to war against the lion man of Moab, you know? And if you look at the black obelisk of Shalmaneser III, it shows the lion men. It shows these people who are taller than elephants walking these dudes that have lion bodies and human heads. And Shalmaneser, King Shalmaneser, is referred to in the book of either 1st or 2nd Kings, I believe. That stuff's in your scriptures, if you know where to look. And again, the Nephilim that we find in the postal world are Nephilim that came from other Nephilim. They're not Nephilim that came from angels. It says point blank in Numbers 13:33 that these were Nephilim that came from other Nephilim. These are the Anakim, who came from Anak, who came from Arba, who's an Amorite, son of Canaan, son of Ham, who stepped off the ark with no mention of angels. So, with all that as a backdrop, let's talk about the potential of the return of the Nephilim in the last days. Are they coming back? Well, going back to that chart, looking at what happened, Yeshua said it was as the days of Noah, right? Not the days of Jared. Now, after the first generation Nephilim were killed, the first generation, the watchers, were judge-bound and buried for how long? 70 generations, right. We get that information from 1 Enoch chapter 10, verse 12. For 70 generations they shall be buried. Well, Psalm 90, verse 10 defines a generation as 70 years, 80th by strength. Well, if you just went on the low side, 70 times 70, 4,900 years, from roughly 3,000 BC, brings us to the beginning of the 20th century. 4,900 years from 3,000 BC, beginning of the 20th century. Makes you wonder, I mean, think about that. Think about the 20th century. Think about the Industrial Revolution in the end of the 1800s and crossing over into the 1900s. It was basically a flat line, right, in terms of transportation, you know, horse and buggy, beast of burden, stuff like that, to all of a sudden locomotives, you know, planes, trains, automobiles, supposedly sending people to the moon and, you know, airplanes and, you know, space probes and all that in like 50 years, 60 years, you know, less than 100 years. What happened? Well, I think we may be looking at the return of the Watchers. I think that they maybe are being systematically released. I don't know if they're all released at the same time. But if you look at the Book of Enoch, of what the Watchers taught men to do, and you look at what men started doing in the 20th century, it's a really good match. You know, I was looking at some information regarding knowledge and transportation in a pre-flood world, I believe was way more advanced than we are. What we're doing with computers and stuff, I believe they were doing with their brain. I think they were doing, you know, they had a better understanding of crystals and all kinds of stuff. I mean, I think they were far more advanced than we are today. Of course, the flood narrows it down to 8 people, you know. And then after that, they start to repopulate the earth. And by the time you get to the Tower of Babel, you got about 600,000 men, at least, by the time of the Tower of Babel. And so, you know, assuming that some of that wisdom and understanding was retained in Noah and his 3 sons, and was passed on to the successive generations, they're all together in the plains of Shinar under the leadership of Nimrod, and their plan is to build a tower to reach into heaven. And if you keep reading throughout the other texts, their plan was to kill God. Effectively, they're like, oh, really? God wiped out the whole pre-flood world? Huh. All right, let's take God out. That's what their plan was. So God said, oh, yeah, I'm going to mess up your languages, which was a brilliant move on God's part. Because if this is what they're going to do with all this wisdom and understanding, what better way to knock all that wisdom down than to confuse everybody's languages so that you can't understand what the other guy's saying? So there were 70 different people groups, 70 different languages. They all went away from the same place talking about the same god, Nimrod, now with different names because they have different languages. We'll talk about that in the next session. They all go away. Now, what happens if you got, like, you know, you got Tesla and Einstein in your group? And then this other group over here has Pee Wee Herman, you know. And, you know, well, not much good. You know, these guys are the guys going to be, you know, carving on caves, you know. There's a pretty horse, you know. You know, you see how wisdom, knowledge, and understanding can be easily chopped way down from what it was just by the act of confusing languages? Easily. And then it kind of fluctuates, you know, and transportation stays pretty much the same. Horse and buggy, beast of burden. You know, there's some peaks and valleys of knowledge and wisdom and understanding. But then you hit the late 1800s, early 1900s, and last days, knowledge shall increase. You also have characters showing up in the beginning of the 20th century, like Aleister Crowley. Showing up, he does, in January through March of 1918, famed occultist Aleister Crowley began a series of magical experiments called the Amalatra Workings, in which he is said to have opened a portal to another dimension, allowing an entity, I believe a demon, or possibly a fallen angel, named Lamb, to enter through it. Could this have been one of the ways that these guys were released? You know, their prison sentence was nearing an end anyway, if not coming to an end completely. And then through the act of man, these guys start being released, maybe. Interesting, this is the picture he drew in 1918 of the entity that came through. Looks a whole lot like the alien greys of today's pop culture. Interesting. Well, he had some disciples, namely Jet Propulsion Laboratory founder and rocket fuel scientist Jack Parson and Scientology and Dianetics founder L. Ron Hubbard. These guys were disciples of Crowley. And in March of 1946, at a location that later became known as Area 51, these guys started doing an experiment they called the Babylon Working. Like the Amalatra Working, it was based on ceremonial sex magic. Unlike Crowley, however, they were not as adept at opening and closing portals, and theirs apparently stayed open, and the modern UFO era began 1 year later, 1947, the same year Crowley died. Interesting timing. Is it also just coincidental that at the same time when all that's going on, the Dead Sea Scrolls are found? From 1946 to 1956, they kept finding stuff in these caves that were buried, like the Book of Enoch. And if you open up the Book of Enoch and read chapter 1, the first couple of verses says, this book is not written for this generation, but for a remote future generation who is to come that will live in the day of tribulation. How many of you think we're getting close to the last days? It says right in the first few verses of Enoch, hey, this is for that generation. And we just so happen to find these books. That's why I think there's value in these books. Because they give us a great deal of information about what was going on with these watchers the first time around. And if they're being released, they're going to be doing a lot of deceiving, right? This whole weekend is called Decoding Deception. Well, a whole lot of deception is coming from these guys. I think the timing is really interesting. You know, again, is it just a coincidence that these books are popping up, you know, right at a time such as this? And I mentioned Daniel earlier, you know, where it talks about in the last days knowledge shall increase. Well, Daniel also says in Daniel 2:43, whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they, who's they, shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. So we have human seed being mixed with they. Who are they? But they, whoever they are, shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. I think this is a prophetic, this is something that may be being fulfilled in the whole alien abduction thing. If you start looking into people like Dr. David Jacobs and others that do interviews with people who claim to have been abducted and had things done to them, over and over and over and over again, you hear testimony of them putting in, being put into like a laboratory type setting where they're having seed and eggs extracted and, you know, embryos implanted and fetuses removed. It's all very scientific. There's blending taking place there, but it's not taking place through copulations. They're not having sex. It's all very scientific. I think that's what this could be, you know, a fulfillment of this prophecy right here. Again, I'll point to what Yeshua said, as the days of Noah, not the days of Jared. The days of Jared were marked by mating of angels and humans. I don't think they're mating with us anymore. They could be doing things through genetic manipulation, you know, like in the alien abduction scenarios. But when it comes to the days of Noah, we see that that's when the creation of animal-human hybrids took place that brought about the corruption of all flesh and the judgment of the flood. If I'm to take Yeshua's words literally, all I have to do is watch the evening news. More and more so these days. In fact, I don't know if you guys were following my YouTube channel and stuff. If you were, hopefully you did cast your vote. But I do not believe our votes count in terms of presidents. But I think we still have a voice at least some of the things. And we were given an opportunity to express our concerns regarding the lifting of the ban of blending of animals and humans. There was a ban that was imposed on the whole idea of blending humans and animals together, that they were put a proposal that said that they were going to consider lifting that ban, but they wanted to hear from us by, I think it was the 6th, just a few days ago. So I had found out about it like around September 1st, I think. I was like, oh man, we got like 6 days here, holy cow, you know. So I put out a video just saying, guys, please, this is not good. Now we know it, the inevitable is going to happen. It doesn't necessarily mean it has to happen on our watch. You know, when I look at 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then he says, I'll hear you. I'll heal your land. I mean, we know what's going to happen. Revelation, you know, a lot of prophetic scriptures, we know it's going to happen. But that doesn't mean it has to happen on my watch. I think we can push some of these things off. You know, there's plenty of places in scripture that show that we can. Now, I know a lot of prophecy guys out there think tomorrow's the end of the world. You know, the rapture's any second now. A comet's going to come or something. There's always something in September. last September 23rd was the big hot button, if you remember. Personally, I think we probably have as little as 18 more years to go, possibly as much as 80, based on the research that I've been doing. I hope I'm wrong. You know, that doesn't mean that if we have 18 or 80 years that it's going to be good. But my opinion is we're not in the days of Noah yet. We are taking our beginning first steps. We're in the phase of the flare going off in Genesis 6:3. Genesis 6:3 was the warning shot. You guys, you better knock it off. 120 years. You know, if what we're reading about and what we're hearing about in the news about what's happening with animal-human hybridization, if that's what they're telling us, what do you think they're not telling us? You know, I'm not so naive to think that, yeah, if we cast our vote, you know, we don't want the ban lifted, it's not going to happen. Look, I know DARPA exists. I know they're creating super soldiers. I know there's probably islands of Dr. Moreau out there. I know other nations are doing their thing. My issue was I don't want you using my tax dollars to do that. You know, I am not in support of that. Yeah, crazy stuff's going on. We are taking our beginning steps. We're seeing it all the time. When I think of transhumanism, I think it's a doctrine of devils. When we go back to what I showed you at the beginning of this presentation with the three promises of the serpent, right? We're a promise of immortality. Your eyes shall be open. You have greater wisdom and understanding, right? And you shall be as gods, okay? Look at those three promises right there. Keep them in mind as you listen to the words of Professor Nick Bostrom.
Well,
hang on.
Interested in is to try to understand the bigger picture for humanity, our place in the world, and what might lie in store for our species in the future, particularly the way we might use technologies to enhance ourselves or to go beyond what we currently think of as our human nature, whether it might be by radically extending the human lifespan through solving the problem of aging, or increasing our intellectual capacities, improving our memory, or taking control of our own emotional states. I think that we are right now in a transitional phase where before the end of this century, we will either have gone extinct or we will have most likely taken the step to become what you might call transhumans or posthumans or just very enhanced humans that have reached their full potential.
The same three promises in the same order. In the exact same order. Wow. If you go to his website, Professor Nick Bostrom is one of the more vocal spokespersons for transhumanism. He has this chart on his website, and he says, you know, this circle right here, this represents what humans can see, hear, taste, touch, smell. This is what our senses, what we are capable of perceiving. He says the animal kingdom, however, has this realm right here. We know that some animals can see in different frequencies that we can't see in. They can hear in frequencies that we can't hear. They can, you know, you have the radar of a bat, the sonar of a dolphin, right? We know that various creatures have abilities that we don't have. So he says, well, what if we blend humans and animals together? We might end up with these abilities right here. And if we keep messing around with the genome and keep messing around, you know, with transhumanism and stuff, we might end up with this really big oval right there. And basically, these guys are saying we'll become like God. We will become the gods. That's what they're saying. That's right there on their website. Now let's talk about genetic transhumanism. There's also the variety of transhumanism that deals with the blending of humans and machines. So how many of you know what the singularity is? Yeah. Singularity is the technical creation of smarter than human intelligence. They're talking about, you know, there's going to come a time where computers are going to surpass humanity, and it's all over after that. You're in Skynet, you know, Blade Runner, Terminator. You're in that realm after that. And they have all these Time magazines, you know, covers, you know, one of them right there, 2045, the year man becomes immortal, shows a dude with a plug in the back of his head. If you go to 2045.com, 2045.com, just read about the 2045 Strategic Home, Social Initiative. The 2045 Strategic Social Initiative. They have stated objectives. And right there, right now, they're into the 2015 to 2020, and they're already making strides to achieve their milestones here. So they're on a good trajectory to meet their other ones. And their stated objective is to achieve immortality, we would say parenthetically apart from God, by the year 2045. So I can't really see much beyond 2045. I mean, if we're still here, it's going to be crazy. I mean, truth is going to be way stranger than any science fiction that we've seen in the past, in my opinion. Nephilim and prophecy. Well, this is one of several scriptures that I could point to that I would suggest may be references that would lead us to believe that we could be dealing with Nephilim in the very near future, is where we see the beast that thou sawest was and is not and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. Where does beast come from? Okay. Keep that in mind for the next presentation. And go into perdition. They that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life for the foundation of the world. Who are these people? What happens if you reject Yeshua as your Savior? If you don't accept Jesus as your Savior, what happens to your name? It's blotted out, right? Well, you can't blot something out unless it was there to begin with. It had to have already been there. I basically believe that it's like whenever I do public speaking, I just say, look, you know, get me there and give me a hotel room to stay, and I'll speak anywhere. You know, I don't charge to speak or anything like that. Just get me there and put a roof over my head. So when I come to an event like this, I just have to go over to the counter over there, give them my name, and my room has already been paid for. Right? Typically, my name's already on the register. All I have to do is confirm my reservation. Price has been paid. I think it's essentially the same thing. Our name was put in from the foundation of the world. All we have to do is confirm our reservation. Yeshua paid a very high price to get you that mansion, right? It's coming. But if you show up and you say, well, I mean, we paid the price. Everything's paid for. You rejected it. Why? I don't know why you chose to do that. Sorry, dude. I'm going to have to blot your name out. You know, you reject it, you get blotted out. If you accept it, you just confirmed your reservation. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So then who are these people whose names are never written? I think they're people that are never meant to exist in the first place, in my opinion. These are probably created in laboratories, or these are probably, you know, various abominations that were not meant to exist in the first place. Now, I'm going to play a video here. How many of you have heard of CRISPR? CRISPR technology. This is going to explain just how far we are into this right now. Again, if this is what they're telling us, just imagine what they're not telling us.
If the old techniques of genetic manipulation were like a map, CRISPR is like a GPS system. Aside from being precise, cheap, and easy, CRISPR offers the ability to edit live cells, to switch genes on and off, and target and study particular DNA sequences. It also works for every type of cell: microorganisms, plants, animals, or humans. Over 3,000 genetic diseases are caused by a single incorrect letter in your DNA. We are already building a modified version of Cas9 that is made to change just a single letter, fixing the disease in the cell. In a decade or two, we could possibly cure thousands of diseases forever. But all of these medical applications have one thing in common. They are limited to the individual and die with them. Except if you use them on reproductive cells or very early embryos. But CRISPR can and probably will be used for much more. The creation of modified humans, designer babies, and will mean gradual but irreversible changes to the human gene pool. Modified humans could alter the genome of our entire species because their engineered traits will be passed on to their children and could spread over generations, slowly modifying the whole gene pool of humanity. It will start slowly. The first designer babies will not be overly designed. It's most likely that they will be created to eliminate a deadly genetic disease running in a family. As the technology progresses and gets more refined, more and more people may argue that not using genetic modification is unethical because it condemns children to preventable suffering and death and denies them the cure. But as soon as the first engineered kid is born, a door is opened that can't be closed anymore. Early on, vanity traits will mostly be left alone. But as genetic modification becomes more accepted and our knowledge of our genetic code enhances, the temptation will grow. If you make your offspring immune to Alzheimer, why not also give them an enhanced metabolism? Why not throw in perfect eyesight? How about height or muscular structure? Full hair? How about giving your child the gift of extraordinary intelligence? Huge changes are made as a result of the personal decisions of millions of individuals that accumulate. This is a slippery slope. Modified humans could become the new standard. But as engineering becomes more normal and our knowledge improves, we could solve the single biggest mortality risk factor, aging. Two-thirds of the 150,000 people who die today will die of age-related causes. Currently, we think aging is caused by the accumulation of damage to our cells, like DNA breaks and the systems responsible for fixing those wearing off over time. But there are also genes that directly affect aging. A combination of genetic engineering and other therapy could stop or slow down aging, maybe even reverse it. We know from nature that there are animals immune to aging. Maybe we could even borrow a few genes for ourselves. Some scientists even think biological aging could be something that eventually just stops being a thing. We would still die at some point, but instead of doing so in hospitals at age 90, we might be able to spend a few thousand years with our loved ones. Even further into the future, we could engineer humans to be equipped for extended space travel and to cope with different conditions on other planets, which would be extremely helpful in keeping us alive in our hostile universe. The technology is certainly a bit scary, but we have a lot to gain, and genetic engineering might just be a step in the natural evolution of intelligent species in the universe. We might end disease. We could extend our life expectancy by centuries and travel to the stars. There's no need to think small when it comes to this topic. Whatever your opinion on genetic engineering, the future is approaching no matter what. What has been insane science fiction is about to become our new reality, a reality full of opportunities and challenges.
just so you know, this technology is extremely inexpensive.
Yes.
From what I understand, it's under $10,000 to get this equipment and probably with a little bit of training, start doing your own thing. And so from what I understand, this already, you know, high schools have these things, colleges are having these things. I mean, that's how easy it is becoming to start tinkering with the human genome. We are in the days of Noah. We're taking those steps. And they're just, these guys are telling you, it's inevitable. This is going to happen. You're going to start seeing people that are hybrids. Did you see how many pictures they showed of people with tails and wings? And, you know, interesting, though, that they said, you know, it may just be part of normal evolution, and they showed aliens sitting there. Now, I don't believe that there are aliens. I believe we're dealing with fallen ones. Deception. Exile. The problem is, you know, when Adam and Eve fell for the deception and went into disobedience, they were just exiled from the garden. When we get to this point, we're being exiled from eternity, from with God. We're being exiled from the kingdom. That's a big problem. Again, I'm going to refer to that. I think Nephilim basically essentially amounts to when that which has fallen from the original state. And I think that's what's taking place. Now, when it comes to all this stuff, you know, I talk about all these things and sometimes people get a little bit freaked out. I don't want to leave you in fear. Scripture says that my people perish for what? Okay, so if people perish for lack of knowledge, what if we got educated? You know, so I'm just trying to show you what's going on. This is what's happening. But I want to encourage you because there's a really interesting conversation that took place in Caesarea Philippi. And I never really understood the significance of that conversation until I stood in the location where the conversation took place. In 2005. That location, that's at the base of Mount Hermon. Caesarea Philippi is at the base of Mount Hermon, where the 200 Watcher-class angels landed in the days of Jared. And there, at that time, when Yeshua was there with his disciples, there was the altar to the Greek god Pan, and a whole bunch of other Greek gods were represented there as well. And then if Pan's right here, then off to the left was a place known and is still known to this day as the Gate of Hades. It's a cave at the base of Mount Hermon. And Yeshua says, "Who do men say that I am?" And the disciples are like, "Well, some say Jeremiah, one of the prophets, whatever, blah, blah, blah." And, you know, Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus says, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. I also say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades," plural, "will not overpower it." I never understood, why does Yeshua get so excited about, you know, Peter says, "You're the Christ." Well, other people, the demons said it all the time. "You're the Christ, you're the Son of God." He told him, "Be quiet." We picked Nathaniel, he said, "You are the Christ." He says, "Why? Because I saw you under the fig tree, you know, at the beginning of his ministry." So I mean, he had people telling him he's the Christ, the Son of God, all through his ministry. Demons are saying it, people are saying it. So what's the big deal when Peter says it? I think the big deal is Peter understood the significance of the location. We knew that Peter understood what happened in the book of Enoch because he later writes about it. The angels that sinned were bound in chains and put in Tartarus. Peter figured it out. So I'm a filmmaker, so I kind of, the way I envision this, the conversation is, if you can imagine, like, this is the altar of Pan right here and all the other gods, and Jesus is standing here with his back to that, and you're Peter looking this way. You know, at Yeshua. And I can just see Peter thinking to himself, he knows who we think he is. Why is he asking this? And if I'm shooting the scene, the way I would see it is like, you know, Peter's point of view, he's looking at Yeshua in focus, and all of a sudden Yeshua goes out of focus and Pan comes in focus, and then Pan goes out of focus and Yeshua comes back in focus, and a light bulb goes off and Peter goes, oh, I get it. You are the Christ. You are the Son of the living God, not these pagan Greek gods and all this other stuff. Peter understood the significance of the location where they were standing. And that's why Yeshua got excited. So, oh, you get it. I want you to get it. If you're looking at Mount Hermon, it was a very strategic place for Yeshua to bring his disciples. His destination is Jerusalem. So he takes this massive detour to go all the way up to northern Israel, southern Lebanon, to stop at Caesarea Philippi to ask this, to have this conversation? Really? And then he takes, I think it was Peter, James, and John, to the top of a high mountain. It's the highest mountain in the region, so many scholars believe, as I also believe, that he took them to the top of Mount Hermon, to ground zero where the angels landed. whose goal, the first prophecy in the Bible, was that this Eve's seed was going to crush the devil's head. So if you're the devil and you're hearing that prophecy, her seed's going to crush your head, what do you think you're going to do to her seed? You're going to mess it up. That's a bad thing, getting your head crushed, right? So if the prophecy is her seed's going to crush my head, well, I'm going to mess up her seed then. That's what took place in Genesis chapter 6. And the promised seed himself, the guy who showed up, the fulfillment of that prophecy, the seed of Eve, finally shows up and steps on ground zero. The plan was hatched to try to get rid of him from ever happening in the first place. If you look down from Mount Hermon, you know, down, if you're on Mount Hermon facing Israel, down sort of to the left right there is the fortress of Nimrod. It's right there. This is the area where they would have had the conversation right there. That's the cave. That's the gate of Hades, which is also depicted over here. That's actual. He was standing in front of the gate of a gate of Hades when he said the gates of Hades are not going to prevail. And it takes him to the top of a high mountain. This is the top of Mount Hermon today, where they have a UN radar outpost up there. I understand the strategic location, you know, with Syria, Lebanon, and all that. There may be other reasons too, though. Especially if you start researching satanic ritual abuse, SRA, you'll find a lot of stories traced back to that spot right there in current today satanic ritual abuse situations. But there's also a cross set up there, where people put that there because they believe that's where the Mount of Transfiguration, where that event took place. I believe that that's where it took place as well. Moral of the story, the whole thing is, look, do not be deceived. We know there's a coming great deception, right? It's going to be so great that even the elect could be deceived by it, right? If it be possible, the text says. I'm going to submit to you, it's very possible. I think that we're already deceived about a great many things. Some people say, well, it says if it be possible, that means it's not going to be possible. Are you kidding me? You know, do we need to talk about Christmas? Do we need to talk about Easter? How many things do we got to talk about? We're already deceived about. And when the disciples came to Yeshua, they said, what's it going to be like the last days when you come back? The first thing he says, let no man deceive you. So if it's not possible to be deceived, why did he start out with, don't let anybody deceive you? It's going to be very possible. So, you know, hopefully throughout this weekend, as each of us go through our presentations, this will help us all not to be deceived. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video presentation. If you did, please subscribe to my YouTube channel, like the video, and share it on your favorite social media sites. There's a lot more to come, so stay tuned, and we'll see you back next time.